Amen.
You all pray for me because I got a message that said, talk about men and boys helping ladies. I didn't have no further instruction than that, so just bear with me, giving honor to Pastor in his absence, and thank God for you all being here on today. The Lord allowing you to make it safely, and hope you all have a wonderful, blessed day. All right, so I'm going to go to Proverbs, the first chapter. I'll read verses 1 through 9. The Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to receive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment, and equity, to give separately to the simple, to the young man, knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and will increase learning, and a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels. To understand a proverb in the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother, for they shall be an ornament of grace unto thy head and chains about thy neck. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. So Solomon was the son of David, the king of Israel. He was a great king and the son of a great king. That meant everyone knew Solomon. He was famous, powerful, and supreme in authority. People bowed in his presence. They respected what he said. And even kings should respect their mother. Solomon's mother was Bathsheba. David and Bathsheba got together in some unfortunate circumstances, which were displeasing to God, and you can reference that in 1 Kings 2 and 19. However, Bathsheba, she went to King Solomon to speak to him for Adonijah, and the king arose to meet her. He bowed before her and sat on his throne. Then he had a throne set for the king's mother, and she sat on his right. Then they had their conversation. He rose for her, he bowed to her, and he called for a throne to be put beside his for their conversation. She was his mother. Even kings should stoop when their mothers enter the room. And we know nowadays that really doesn't happen when a mother comes in a room. Sometimes a child doesn't even pay attention to their parent or to any authority for that matter. But Genesis 1 and 27 says, and God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created male and female. He created them, and God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. Genesis 2 and 24 says, a man shall leave his father and his mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. A man shall leave his father and mother. Did you say that? Okay. A covenant relationship between one man and one woman. God's idea of the heart of the family. However, things happen sometimes, and there may be a single parent family. And so, again, the message that I got just said, men and boys helping ladies, so that could just be broad in any kind of way. So I'm not going to do all the talking. I'll probably ask you some questions and help you, have you help me? All right, so in Proverbs 1 and 8, though, it's saying that it's father instructs and mothers teach. The responsibility is to be shared by both parties. Boys and young men should listen to their parents, especially if they're being raised by a single mother, but it doesn't matter, single or not, they still should listen, and not to write off what the parent says. Obey the word of God as God instructs you to. And in Exodus 20 and 12, it says, honor your father and mother. You honor your father by listening respectfully when he speaks, and honor your mother by remembering what was taught to you, right or wrong, about the fear of God. So men can be examples to the boys by showing them how to treat women, how to create a world where men and boys are loving and respectful, and treat women and girls with respect, value them, protect them, keep them safe, and teach them how to communicate and how to work together as a team with ladies and girls. So one thing I want to ask you, and I want feedback, how do you feel about men showing emotions? You know, some people think that men shouldn't show emotions. emotions. It's weak for a man to cry. What do you all feel? What do you think? Open for discussion.
That wasn't rhetorical.
Talk to me.
It depends what type of emotion it is. I think that's the key. It depends on the type of emotion. If it's a positive emotion, you want to share it. If it's negative, you don't want to share it. You want to keep anything negative to yourself. Because if you look at, like, as a man, for example, of having that faith in God, or if you're in a relationship, you want that woman to view you as a source of strength. If you engage in negative emotion in conversation, subconsciously, that woman is not going to respect you because she can't respect a guy who's not fit to be a leader in and of himself. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense.
Yes,
yeah.
Dr. Ross, on that emotional part, especially when it comes to crying, like on Wick Church, I think I heard some man who was supposed to cry. There were some ladies said they will respect men more so if they did show emotion. We know at funerals, like when my mother, when she passed, I did cry. And my wife came and embraced me, and which was good. And I was showing that I still have emotion. So they look at male as being a tough part of the home because the home needs a balance. It has father and mother. And many times fathers is viewed as being the tough guy. But sometimes in some homes it's reversed, where the mother is tough.
Cracking that whip,
huh? And the father is more who's going around mending wounds. So, but either way, you gotta have a balance in that home. But it's okay to show emotion. We're not stoned. We still have feelings. We still laugh. We still feel. We're still sensitive to things. So it's okay to be emotional at times.
Yes. And it shows humility. Jesus wept.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
And I really, I didn't feel moved when my father died.
Holding doors, help her carry her stuff, pull out her chair, encourage her, and pray for her. Those of you that just walked in, I had got a message that said, talk about men and boys helping ladies. So that's kind of what we're discussing for the moment. I won't be here for you long. But there is a crisis going on between men, boys, women, and girls. And now they have the women's liberation movement, the feminist movement, and the NOW, which is the National Organization Movement, and the Me Too movement, which has caused a wedge between man and woman. And now we're losing a relationship for man and woman. And the first commandment that God gave to Adam was that a man should leave his mother and cleave to his wife. And if we were to have a practical application, the first teacher that most boys had is with their mother. And if you could give me 10 ideas what you think how a man should treat, or a man or a boy should treat a woman, what are some of your ideas? And how it relates to the church? Sister Pinker?
This makes me think back to my grandson when he was a little. He didn't realize he was heavy handed. Because they told me he hit me a couple of times as I found out. But the thing that I was trying to teach him was, No hitting. Wait a minute, I always put in no hitting grandma, but no hitting, you know, because I wanted him to know, no, it's not proper, it is not good. You know hitting, no one, period. know, with that thought continually in his mind, you know, don't raise your feet. You know what I'm saying? Things that used to be said to us as children. You know, you don't raise your feet at people, like you're going to kick them and things like that. Use your inside voice, because sometimes verbally people can be intimidating. You know, things like that. And so in trying to teach him those things, because that's something that grows up with him. You know, will grow up with him. And nowadays, you've got all this electronic stuff that's in their face. And they see things that are totally different. They're hearing things that are totally different than what I was telling them. You see what I'm saying? And so he's looking at this stuff and may think, oh, Brenda didn't know what she was talking about. Because it looked okay over there. No, no hitting. You know, no kicking, no violence, you know, none of that kind of stuff right there. And so that's what I was trying to work him into.
So what if somebody hit him?
Somebody hit him? Oh, his mother could take
him. Commissioner, I was thinking about that. To me, the greatest thing you can teach your son or male, if you are going to be having anything to do with them in their lives, trying to be an example in it, is how to love.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because so many times, yes. Men are taught to be very hard, you know, right. And love is a great emotion, mm-hmm. but they need to be taught how to love and what love really means and how to express and how to give.
Yes.
And if you do that, then a man, you know, the other things are kind of fall in place, because a man will know how to respect a woman, you know how to treat a woman, mm-hmm. and do all those things. Then he'll know what the reason he is and why he's with that woman. So many times as a young man, we growing up, we think we with that woman because we're after one thing that woman has to offer us. But if we learn how to love and understand what love is and how the Bible talks about love, then we'll be able to respect her when she sets boundaries and say, no, this is how the relationship is going to go. So then that man is able to respect her and treat her as such as a lady should be treated. So I think we really need to employ that and teach our children, our young men, really how to love and what it's all about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're dealing with a whole different generation of people right now. You know, they haven't got a clue. They don't go to church. They don't know anything. Their family don't know anything about church. They teach it. I got a school bus pull up. They don't have a clue as to what they want to do. I mean, they don't have to talk to your Christian girls out there. They pick them up and get them going on like you wouldn't believe. And I have to just, but it's the worst situation I have ever seen in my life. And I'm glad that I'm out there because, you know, I'm beginning to put some things into their mind, like, let's work together. Let's, look out for your brother. You see him standing up, you got to see, look over, let him sit out. They don't even know the simple stuff. What are you talking about, love? When they're doing this, when the music and stuff that they listen to is so radical, it's just out of sight. It's out of this world, the stuff that they listen to. How are we going to preach them? How are we going to teach them anything about your love? I mean, what are they going to
Yeah.
We see nothing here.
I need another pinker then, Brother Marcus.
And listen to a talk that tells me respect isn't being taught in the homes. And based off what Elder Love said, based off what Elder Green said, if we teach love, it makes it easier to usher in these other things. They are very disrespectful today, which means we have to take a bolder stance. When we see it, tell them this isn't right. You know, it may not be my son, it may not be my daughter. Stop, that's not proper. And need to put something in there, and the best teacher is going to be at home, but when there's a failure at home, you can't depend on the other institutions to fill in where the home has fallen down. But we have to teach them some respect.
Brother Marcus?
You know, I was going to add, I think that keeping in mind that we're trying to form leaders.
Yes.
And I think that's one of the things that I've noticed with today's generation. It's like the boys are kind of not so much passive in a negative way, but it's like they're not being taught that they're the ones that need to be the authority, not in a way that demeans people or puts people down, but in a way that is God.
less than they could have. They didn't learn. You know, they didn't have any teaching.
So like if we had say some women that came in and just learned the church and they don't know our teachings and the men are trying to help them and the boys are trying to help them, but they don't want to hear you because they're an independent woman, and so they don't want to respect men or they don't like men. As saints of God, how do you think we should deal with that?
Right.
Brother Marcus?
Well, I think that people have to be taught. You know, I think sometimes we assume that people just know. Like, I remember hearing the testimony of a lady who got saved, and she said, you know, she kept smoking. And, you know, she was outside the church smoking one day, and somebody said, you're not supposed to do that. And she said, I'm not. She said, nobody ever told me that I shouldn't smoke. Now, she got the message then, but I think it's the same thing with this. Sometimes people, if they used to live in a certain way, they may not even know that there's a whole nother way that they should live. So I think that's where, like, teaching comes in, and being willing to bring them into our lives.
We gotta look at now. We gotta look at the time now and back. You know, let's say 3,000 years ago, when life was a fight for survival, and men had to go out and do physical things. They had to essentially do something that was going to benefit the tribe in some sort of way. Because of modern society, is you don't have to fight for survival anymore. It's pretty easy to get taken care of. You know, those natural principles that were once taught amongst younger boys are not there anymore. And because some people might agree with. Disagree with me on this, but women naturally are a little smarter and more cunning than men. So when it comes to certain types of influential situations, women generally can win. That's why if you look at back all the powerful kings of the day, they were surrounded by a bunch of women because they're the ones that got the ideas. However, the men had the courage then to put the good ideas in place. So I think the main thing is just a lack of courage in today's males.
Dr. Green?
Going back to your question on that, I would think and would hope that you would have the seasoned mothers in the church mm-hmm. to be able to talk to those young women, yes. explain them the importance of the roles, the relationship, and mentor them. And that's one of the things that is really lacking in the church today. It's not enough mentorship going on to be able to pass down to the generations. And that's why you see Hellraisers today. That's why you see the things that survives you see on the buses and things of that nature. Because it's nothing to pass down the homes of fatherless and broken and everything else. So it really puts a real strain on the church and some kind of way we have to come up with new ideas and new ways of doing things to be creative and really try to get the family structure back because the enemy does not want the family to be structured. Because if he can dissect the family, then he knows that he can work on things and destroy the man and the woman. So he'll put a man and a woman battling against one another, have them competing against one another, and things of that nature, instead of them working together and trying to establish something together.
What about with like the Me Too movement and some of those other things I had named before? So like men and boys, you have to be careful in the church these days because you might shake a woman's hand and she might take it the wrong way. Mm-hmm. And then what? How do you as men, boys, or anybody, how do you protect yourself? I mean, we're saints of God and you know you don't mean any harm by shaking somebody's hand, but if someone takes offense to it, what do you think is the best way to handle that as saints of God to protect yourself? Because you're coming to worship, but someone might take it an incorrect way.
You have to look at your action and not the outcome. Because the action is, I would do that in that case. I would be doing it with positive intent. So if you have I would give some of God's blessing to this person. If they perceive that the wrong way, that's not my fault for wanting to actually go spread that.
Yes, that I like that. Plus, I would also have someone else with me when I'm in the presence of such a person. And probably would be my wife or some other mother in the church. But don't get isolated for a person like that. That's going to get you a lot of trouble. It's going to be very costly trying to prove you're innocent protect yourself, have a witness. I'll allow the two or three, Mike said, shall that word be established.
Amen.
Right, you don't want your good to be spoken of.
So true.
You always want to make sure, like, if you say you have wisdom, and you cover yourself. As growing up, a mentor taught us that, you know, you don't ever counsel people without having somebody there.
Right.
That way you have somebody that's also not just to cover you, but to speak for you and to know what's really going on in your half. Because people will try to get you caught up in a trick bag. They will try to tarnish your name. Because
yes.
The enemy knows he can ruin your name. You know, they don't have to be true.
Right.
But once it get out there,
right,
it's hard to really to get that to retract it, because people will run with it like a wildfire.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you just speak it out. You know, you can use these things openly. Just say, oh, excuse me, I didn't mean to offend you. I'm sorry.
Assume they notice,
yeah,
and they will come out and stand and what we're doing, we're making a difference. I'm using these opportunities to teach them. Open the door. And I do it for my wife, because I want others to see, you know, open the door for